فإذا كنت تريد أن تكون على مذهب السلف تعلم مذهب السلف وما هم عليه.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم taught us many du'as. He taught his companions and therefore the ummah many du'as, many ways to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and many things to ask him jalla wa ala. From the things that the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam used to say is Allahumma inni as'aluka hubbak wa hubba man yuhibbuk wa hubba amalin yuqarribuni ila hubbik. O Allah, I ask you for your love, and I ask you for the love of those who love you, and I ask you for deeds which will bring me closer to your love. This dua, where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asking for these beloved things. Ikhwani fillah, we all need to learn this dua, and we all need to call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this way, in order that He makes us beloved to Him, and He makes Himself beloved to us, and He makes us beloved to the people who love Allah, and He makes the people who love Allah beloved to us as well. And that Allah gives us deeds which will bring us closer to His love. Loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is from the acts of worship. So many people, when you say to them an act of worship, they often think about the outward act. So they often think about the sajda, they often think about the sacrifice, they often think about things like fasting, things like giving the zakah, things like performing the tawaf around the Kaaba. They think about these types of things. But did you know that worship, it also includes the actions of the heart as well? Things like love, things like fear, things like hope, things like reliance. All of these are from the actions of the heart, and they are acts of worship. So Allah Jalla wa Ala, He tells us, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. That from mankind, there are those who take besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rivals. And يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. They love them the way they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they would set up rivals with Allah, and they would love them on a similar level. But Allah then tells us about the love of the believers. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّا لِلَّهِ. But as for those who believe, they are greater and firmer in their love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we as Muslims, we have to love Allah the way we love nothing else. We have to put the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the pleasure of anything else. What I want to do in this short reminder, insha'Allah, is remind myself and yourselves about 10 things which will bring us closer to the love of Allah, and 10 things which will make us beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first of those things, and it is deserved, and it deserves to be the first of those things, is that we recite the Qur'an and we ponder over its meanings and we reflect on its greatness. Allah Jalla wa Ala, He says in the Qur'an, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Will they not reflect over the Qur'an? And then Allah Jalla wa Ala, He says, وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافٍ كَثِيرًا. And if it was from other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they would have found a lot of mistakes within it. Brothers and sisters, this Qur'an is the source of all knowledge. This Qur'an is the source of all knowledge. This Qur'an is the uncreated speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This Qur'an, my brothers and sisters, from the beginning to the end, it is a miracle. This is the same Qur'an about which Allah Jalla wa Ala says, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. Allah says about this Quran that if we sent it down, if we revealed it upon a mountain, you would see the mountain turn to dust and cleft asunder out of the awe and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the great companion Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he told us, you know, don't recite it quickly and don't treat it like old dates. Don't treat it like old dates. Don't recite it quickly like you are reciting poetry. Stop at its wonders and move the heart with it. Subhanallah. Stop at the wonders of the Quran. When Allah Jalla wa'ala is telling you about the creation, when Allah Jalla wa'ala is mentioning His greatness, stop at the wonders and the perfection of this Quran and move your heart with it. Brothers and sisters, if we were to do this, honestly, it would have a major effect on our hearts. Many of us, when we read the Quran, we read it just to get to the end of the chapter, or we read it just to get to the end of the page, or just to get to the end of the section. And we don't actually ponder over its meanings. If we were to just recite a line and then go and read the translation of that line and go and read the tafsir of that line, what does it actually mean? How have the scholars of the Quran explained this? It would add a whole nother level, a whole nother depth to our reading and our understanding of the Quran. Ikhwani fillah, we need to treat our souls with the Quran. The ill soul, the blackened soul, we need to treat it with the Quran. The diseased heart, it needs to be treated with the Quran. The raging nafs needs to be treated with the Quran. The ill body, it needs to be treated with the Quran. This Quran is a healing and it is a cure. And if only we used it and if only we pondered over it the way we should. And so the first way that we can earn the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to increase in our recitation of the Quran, is to increase in our pondering over the Quran, is to increase in our using the Quran to rectify our deficiencies. The second way that we can earn the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that we should fulfill the obligatory actions and then continue to draw closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the voluntary actions. And so what Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he recorded and he reported on the authority of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, who said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that Allah says, this is a hadith Qudsi where the Messenger of Allah is narrating on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, whoever takes a friend of mine, a wali of mine as an enemy, I declare war on him. My slave does not draw closer to me with anything more than what I have made obligatory upon him. And my slave continues to draw closer to me by the supererogatory deeds until I love him. Subhanallah. Allah Jalla wa Ala is telling you that there's nothing that's going to bring you closer to Allah more than the deeds that He's made obligatory upon you. So the first way, the primary step to get closer to Allah is that you do the obligatory actions. And then Allah mentions that He continues to draw closer to me through the voluntary actions, through those nawafil actions. And so you take care of the obligatory first. This is the first stage. And then the second stage is that you continue to draw closer to Allah through the voluntary actions. And then Allah says, until I love Him. Look, we're talking about earning the love of Allah, and Allah is giving us the recipe and the route to His love. Number one, you fulfill all of the obligatory actions. And then number two, you follow that and you get closer to Allah with the voluntary actions. And then Allah says, and if I love Him, then I am His hearing with which He hears, His vision with which He sees, his hand with which he strikes, and his foot with which he walks. If he is to ask me, I would surely give it to him. And if he would seek refuge with me, I would grant him refuge. I do not hesitate about anything more than as I hesitate to take the soul of the believer, because he hates death and I hate to hurt him. Subhanallah. This is the true hadith of wilayah. This is the true hadith of the awliya of Allah. Those people who fulfill the obligatory actions and then they follow it up with the supererogatory actions. You know, we find people today, they say that we are from the awliya of Allah. I am a wali of Allah Jalla wa Ala. And they're not even fulfilling the obligatory actions. And they are calling to shirk and they are calling to innovation. For wallahi, these people are not from the awliya of Ar-Rahman. Rather, they are from the awliya of Ash-Shaytan. Because the first of the obligatory deeds, the most important of the obligatory deeds, is to worship Allah and not associate any partners with Allah, and to make sure that all of your acts of worship, they are sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Ikhwani fillah, this is the most important way that each and every single one of us can get closer to Allah, is that we put everything in its correct place. First thing, at-tawheed. Second thing, doing our best to uphold the obligatory action. So like praying 5 times a day and fasting the month of Ramadan, being good to our parents, etc, etc. All of the obligatory actions, we tick all of those boxes. Now we're on the way to earn the love of Allah. And then we follow that up with the supererogatory deeds. The third way, so the first way is to read the Quran and ponder over the Quran. The second way is to follow that way. Follow the way that the Messenger of Allah has told us, has narrated on Allah. Number one, obligatory actions, do those. Number two, follow those with the nawafil deeds. Number three is to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with our tongues and with our hearts as well. Ikhwani fillah, our tongue should be moist with the remembrance of Allah, like the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised us. And the Messenger of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, he was constantly making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah jalla wa ala tells us in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, addressing those who believe, myself and yourselves, O you who have believed, udhkurullaha dhikran kathira, remember Allah with a lot of remembrance, meaning make a lot of dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is so important, brothers and sisters, that we are constantly making dhikr of Allah. Look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He taught us du'as and adhkar, words of remembrance. From the moment that we wake up, when we wake up, we remember Allah. When we go to the bathroom, we enter, there is a dua. When we leave, there is a dua. When we put our clothes on, there is a dua. When we leave our houses, when we eat our breakfast, there is a dua. After our breakfast, after we eat our food, there is a dua. When we leave our homes, there is a dua. When we get into our cars, there is a dua. When we go out into the marketplace, there is a dua. When we're feeling stressed, there is a dua. When we meet an enemy or a tyrant, there is a dua. There is a dua for literally every single moment of the Muslim's life. Every single situation that the Muslim is going to face himself, you know, he's going to face in his day-to-day life, then there is a dua for that. And what is this other than constantly making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And so we remember that some words of remembrance, they are more beloved to Allah than others. So for example, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, كَلِمَتَانِ خَفِيفَتَانِ عَلَى اللِّسَانِ ثَقِيلَتَانِ فِي الْمِيزَانِ حَبِيبَتَانِ إِلَى الرَّحْمَنِ Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, Subhanallahil Azim. That there are two words, kalimatani, khafifatani ala lisan, they are light and easy upon the tongue. Habibatani ila ar-Rahman, they are beloved to ar-Rahman. So not only are they light on the tongue, but they are beloved to ar-Rahman. Thaqilatani fil mizan, they are heavy in the scales on Yawm al-Qiyamah as well. So when the good deeds are going to be weighed, these actions are going to be heavy, these words are going to be heavy. What are they so easy? Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi, Subhanallahil Azim. Say it now. The Messenger of Allah said they are easy on the tongue. Look how right he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just say it now. Subhanallah wa bihamdihi, subhanallah al-azim. Look how easily they just roll off the tongue. Subhanallah. So remember Allah, jalla wa ala. And if we remember Allah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remember us. The fourth way is that we give precedence to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves over what we ourselves love. Particularly in times of trials and tribulations and fitna and times where everybody seems to be following their desires. Ikhwani fillah, when we put the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala over our own pleasure, we will begin to taste a sweetness. We will begin to taste a sweetness which no amount of money can buy. And particularly in this time where there is a lot of misguidance, the routes to disobey Allah jalla wa ala are many. If you live your life for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you become like that slave. That he will become, Allah says, I will become the hearing with which he hears, the sight with which he sees, the hand with which he strikes, and the foot with which he walks. This doesn't mean that Allah literally comes into that person and becomes his hearing and his sight and his hand and his foot. No, this means when that person reaches a station where Allah loves him and he loves Allah, then he only listens to that which is pleasing to Allah. He only sees and looks at that which is pleasing to Allah. He only does that which is pleasing to Allah, and he only goes to those places which are pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what it means when Allah says, I become the hearing with which he hears, the sight with which he sees, the hand with which he strikes, and the foot with which he walks. And so this is because that person, he puts the pleasure of Allah over his own pleasure. The fifth way that we can earn the love of Allah and become beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that we always reflect on the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers and sisters, Allah has names and he has attributes which he has taught us in the Qur'an, which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam has informed us about in the authentic sunnah. So when we reflect and we ponder over the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we ponder over this creation and we look at it, and we see and we ponder then over the perfection of the one who created it, when we ponder over the mercy of Allah, when we ponder over the knowledge of Allah and the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then inevitably when you are constantly pondering over something, that thing becomes beloved to you. When you're constantly pondering over the names and the attributes of Allah, those perfect names and attributes, inevitably Allah jalla wa ala will begin to become beloved to you. And when that happens, then of course you're going to then obey him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ikhwani fillah, the sixth way is to reflect and to bear witness on Allah's bounties over us. Bear witness and reflect on Allah jalla wa ala's bounties upon us, his kindness and his blessings to us, His countless blessings upon us. Allah jalla wa ala, he says, وَإِن تَعُدُّ نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. That if you tried to count and enumerate the blessings of Allah upon you, you wouldn't be able to do that. Ikhwani fillah, Allah jalla wa ala, he says, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. And you don't have whatever of blessings that you have, فَمِنَ اللَّهِ, it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all of the blessings, all of the mercies, all of the bounties of Allah upon us. The greatest of those bounties is that he made us Muslims and he made us from the people of Iman. The greatest of those bounties is that he guided us to At-Tawheed and he guided us to the Sunnah and that he protected us from Shirk and he protected us from innovation. Ikhwani fillah, I have a question for you. Imagine you had a friend and that friend just kept buying you gifts, gift upon gift upon gift. And you'd say to him, why are you buying me these gifts? He'd say, no reason, I'm just buying them because I love you and I like you. Inevitably, that person, he would become beloved to you. What about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has bestowed so many blessings, so many bounties upon us that we can't even enumerate it? The friend, maybe he buys you the gift because he wants something in return. Maybe he's going to say later on when he needs your help, he's going to say, you know, look, you owe me one because I bought you so many gifts and I was so good to you. And yet Allah Jalla wa Ala, we cannot help Allah in the slightest. Allah Jalla wa Ala doesn't need our assistance. He is free of us. Allah is rich. He doesn't need us in any way, shape or form. He could destroy us and it wouldn't make any difference to his greatness subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yet we can do nothing for him, and yet he gives us so many bounties, so many blessings, blessing upon blessing. And that's why he calls to us and he tells us that if you tried to count my blessings upon you, you wouldn't be able to do so. And so when you ponder over the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your life, then it makes you appreciate and love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And from the important things that we learned from the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not to look at those who have more than us, rather to focus and look at those who have less than us. Because when you look at people, there's always going to be somebody somewhere who has more than you. And when you look at that person and you focus on his blessings and what he has, it makes what you have seem small. But the Messenger of Allah told us to look at those who have less than us. Because when you do that, you actually realize how much you have. You actually realize how many blessings you have in your life. If you can go to the tap and you can open it and clean water comes out, then you're better than half of this world. And if you have a roof over your head, and you have running water, and you know when your next meal is going to come, then you're from the richest and the most blessed people in this dunya. Combine that with your iman. Combine that with your income. Combine that with your clothes. Combine that with your safety. And combine that with all of the rest of the things that you have, that we have. Subhanallah, it makes us appreciate the blessings of Allah, and it makes us realize how much in need we are of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Combined with this, my brothers, the seventh way is to humble ourselves in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to shatter our hearts in front of Him. I have a question. When was the last time that we cried in front of Allah? When was the last time that we cried in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What I mean by this is we cried in salah. We were making dua and we cried. We were calling out to Allah, reading the Quran, and we were crying for no other reason and nobody else saw us. But we were crying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, combined with all of those blessings that He has, yet we still disobey Him. We still commit sins day and night, major and minor, openly and in secret, knowingly and unknowingly. We commit so many sins. We disobey Allah so much, and yet He still continues to bestow His favors upon us. He still continues to grant us so many blessings. And so we don't look at our sins, we look at the greatness of the one who we are disobeying, such that even a single minor sin is something huge. And so, brothers and sisters, we have to turn back to Allah, and we have to raise our hands, and we have to come to Allah as a slave who has disobeyed his master. And we come to our master as slaves who have wronged their own souls. And so we turn back to Allah and we make tawbah to Allah. And Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ التَّوَّابِينَ, that Allah loves التَّوَّابِينَ. And so, إِخْوَانِ فِي اللَّهِ, come to Allah with a humble heart. A heart which is soft. A heart which is broken. A heart which is yearning and calling out to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. The eighth way to earn the love of Allah and to become beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that we seclude ourselves with him in the last third of the night, and we pray and we ponder and we read his book, and then we end the night seeking his forgiveness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ikhwani fillah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that in the last third of the night, Allah jalla wa ala descends to the lowest heaven, and he asks, who is there who is calling upon me so that I may answer him? Who will ask of me that I may give him? Who is seeking my forgiveness so that I may forgive him? This is from the ways that we can earn the love of Allah, is in the last third of the night when the people are sleeping, is to make dua, to read the Qur'an, to pray the salah, and to call out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِعِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا وَمِمَّا رَزَقَنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ. As Allah jalla wa ala says, that their sides, they forsake their beds to invoke their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, خَوْفًا وَطَمَعًا, in hope, in fear and in hope. So their sides abandon the beds, they wake up in the last third of the night in order to call upon Allah in fear and in hope, and they spend in charity out of what we have provided them with. These are the people, subhanallah, that we want to be with, that they leave their beds in the last third of the night and they call upon Allah jalla wa ala when the rest of the people are sleeping. May Allah give us the tawfiq to be from those people. The ninth way is to sit with the people who love Allah and sit with the people who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So be with the people of Tawheed and be with the people of the Sunnah, because Allah loves the people of Tawheed and the people of the Sunnah, and we need to stay away from the people of Shirk and people of innovation. So the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, الرَّجُلُ عَلَى دِينِ خَلِيلِهِ, that a man is upon the religion of his companion. فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِلْ, so let each one of you look at who he takes or who he makes his friend. So brothers and sisters, we are all in need of looking at our companionship and making sure that the people that we spend our time with, they are bringing us closer to the love of Allah and making Allah more beloved to us from their actions and from their speech and from their reminders and from the places that they go and the things that they talk about. If we accompany those people, then inevitably Allah jalla wa ala will become more beloved to us. The next way and the final way is that we stay away from anything which will become a barrier between our hearts and Ar-Rahman. We stay away and we prevent anything that would become a barrier between our hearts and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is none other than sin and disobedience. Sin and disobedience, they make the heart black, and they constrict the chest, and they bring stress, and they bring anxiety, and they straiten and make a person's affairs difficult in this life and in the akhirah. So the slave looks at everything around him and he tries to stay away from anything that will come between him and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when the slave falls into sin, be that a major sin or a minor sin, he turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And remember that Allah is At-Tawwab. Allah is At-Tawwab, meaning he is the one who inspires you to seek forgiveness. He is the one who inspires you to make tawbah. And if Allah didn't guide you to that tawbah, you wouldn't have made the tawbah. So Allah is the one who guides you to make tawbah. And then when you make the tawbah, Allah is the one who accepts that tawbah and he forgives you of that sin. So subhanallah, this is because Allah loves the people who make tawbah. Ikhwani fillah, this is what I have to present to you. So in summary, The first way to earn the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to read and ponder and reflect over the Qur'an. The second way is that we fulfill all of the obligatory actions and then we continue to draw closer to Allah with those supererogatory actions. The fourth way is that we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly with our hearts and with our tongues as well. The fifth way is that we give precedence to what Allah loves over what our own selves and our own desires they love. The sixth way is that we reflect on the names and the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The seventh way is that we reflect on the mercy and the blessings that Allah has bestowed upon us. The eighth way is that we humble ourselves and we reflect and we make tawbah to Allah and we seclude ourselves with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ninth way is that we sit with the people of Tawheed and Sunnah. We sit with the people whom Allah loves. And the final way is that we stay away from anything which will become a barrier between ourselves and the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we end with the dua, Allahumma inna nas'aluka hubbak wa hubba man yuhibbuk wa hubba amalin yuqarribuna ila hubbik. Oh Allah, we ask you for your love and for the love of those who love you and for actions which will bring us closer to your love. So ikhwani fillah, I hope that we are all in need of putting these advices into practice, the speaker first and foremost. So I ask Allah Jalla wa Ala that He makes us from the people whom He loves and that He protects us from the fire and that He resurrects us with the Messenger and those companions. Ultimately, Allah knows best. Until we meet again, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.